In a very important election, voters this fall will decide on the next president of the United States and also on how we may elect our president in the future. It's a complex ballot with many issues at stake, including several tax proposals. We'll look at the issues and the candidates for the November 3rd general election on this edition of Denver Decides. This year's ballot is one of the longest in Denver's history, with a full 23 ballot questions, so you might want to get comfortable. We'll start with the ballot issues. There are several statewide and citywide questions on the ballot. Several of these issues are citizen-initiated measures, meaning citizens gathered enough signatures on a petition, which were then certified by the Secretary of State and placed on the ballot. The other issues were referred to voters by the legislators. With the help of the Colorado Blue Book, the Denver Local Issue Notice, and the League of Women Voters, we'll show you some pros and cons to consider. You can download an interactive sample ballot at denvervotes.org to follow along. You'll find it under the November 2020 Election Info tab. First among the issues are the statewide questions. Going in ballot order, the first issue is Amendment B. This proposal was referred by the state legislature and would repeal several constitutional provisions regarding property taxes, commonly referred to as the Gallagher Amendment. It would repeal the Gallagher Amendment, which requires residential and non-residential property tax revenues to make up the same portion of total statewide property taxes as when the Gallagher Amendment was adopted in 1982. It also repeals the requirement that the non-residential property tax assessment rate be fixed at 29%. Here are the pros and cons for Amendment B.
Those in favor of Amendment B say the Gallagher Amendment is outdated and full of unintended consequences. If the Gallagher Amendment is not repealed, owners of high-end homes in Denver's wealthiest neighborhoods would get a tax cut next year, while small businesses and farmers would pay a larger share of property taxes. The Gallagher Amendment causes small businesses to be taxed at a rate 4 times higher than residential property owners and penalizes rural and low-income communities that lack a significant commercial tax base. Proponents also say Colorado has some of the lowest residential property taxes in the nation. Amendment B fixes property tax assessment rates at their current levels. Amendment B is not a tax increase. Under Amendment B, the property tax rates homeowners and businesses pay could only be increased by a vote of the people. And proponents say Amendment B will prevent deep cuts to schools, hospitals, fire protection, and other local services in many areas of the state. Amendment B allows local governments to continue providing services that their communities expect.
Those opposed say Amendment B results in higher property taxes for homeowners by preventing future drops in the residential assessment rate. Increasing home values have already resulted in higher property taxes for many homeowners. Higher taxes mean that homeowners will have less money to spend or save, and landlords may increase rents at a time when many are already struggling to make ends meet. Opponents also say the current property tax system keeps residential property taxes low and it prevents special interests from obtaining tax breaks at the expense of homeowners. Amendment B removes an important protection for homeowners from the Constitution. Without these protections, homeowners may end up paying an increasing share of property taxes. Opponents also say there are better alternatives to amending the Constitution. Local governments can instead ask their voters to raise tax rates or seek other solutions to provide services such as fire protection, schools, and libraries. These alternatives would allow voters in each local jurisdiction to decide for themselves how to best fund services for their community.
Next up, Amendment C is a proposal referred by the state legislature. It would make changes to the Colorado Constitution to allow revisions to charitable gaming activities. It would allow bingo raffle licensees to hire managers and operators of these games of chance and reduce the required period of existence for a charitable organization to obtain a bingo raffle license from 5 years to 3 years. Here are the pros and cons for Amendment C.
Those in favor of Amendment C say bingo raffle games are an opportunity for nonprofit organizations to raise funds for their programs. allowing nonprofit organizations to compensate workers reduces the burden on nonprofits to provide volunteers to operate the games. Proponents also say expanding licenses to newer nonprofit organizations removes a barrier and provides them with additional fundraising opportunities. By increasing access to bingo raffle fundraising, this measure may help increase funding for nonprofit organizations.
Those opposed to Amendment C say professionalizing bingo raffle operations undermines their charitable fundraising purpose. Paying workers increases overhead to operate games, potentially reducing the amount of money nonprofit organizations are able to raise and dedicate to their core mission. Opponents also say, by removing the requirement that workers be volunteers and expanding the number of nonprofits that participate, bingo raffle games become more like for-profit gambling than charitable fundraising.
Next up is Amendment 76. This proposal is a citizen initiative to change the wording in the Colorado Constitution regarding voting. It would specify that only a citizen of the United States, rather than every citizen of the United States, is eligible to vote in Colorado elections.
Those in favor of Amendment 76 say voting is a fundamental right reserved for U.S. citizens. Amendment 76 guarantees that the state will not be able to pursue policies that allow non-citizens to vote. The measure specifies who can vote in Colorado and provides additional constitutional protections for Colorado's elections.
Opponents say Amendment 76 makes an unnecessary and potentially divisive change. The state already has a secure election system that ensures only those who meet legal requirements can vote in elections. Ultimately, the measure seeks to solve a problem that does not exist, may result in voter confusion about state and local elections, and could discourage and even disenfranchise voters.
Next up, Amendment 77 is a citizen initiative. It proposes amending the Colorado Constitution and the Colorado statutes to allow voters in three gaming cities, Blackhawk, Central City, and Cripple Creek, to increase or remove current bet limits and approve any new casino games in each city. And it would expand the current use of casino tax revenue for community colleges to include student retention and completion programs.
Those in favor of Amendment 77 say it allows voters in Blackhawk, Central City, and Cripple Creek to make decisions that are best for their communities. Local residents impacted by changes to gambling in Colorado are best equipped to address the needs of their communities and should be allowed to control what happens in their cities. Without raising taxes on Coloradans, Amendment 77 will likely increase the amount of funding for community college financial aid, classroom instruction, workforce development, student retention, and degree completion programs. This additional revenue will help provide important educational and employment opportunities during this economic downturn and is essential when recent state and local tax revenues have decreased significantly.
Those opposed to Amendment 77 say removing bet limits may increase the prevalence and severity of problem gambling. Problem gambling often leads to negative social impacts ranging from lower work productivity, financial problems, and higher crime rates to family neglect and abuse, substance abuse, and suicide. It increases the risk of gambling problems without setting aside any of the new tax revenue to help people harmed by problem gambling. Opponents also say expanding casino gambling may negatively impact other communities in Colorado that will no longer have a voice in changes to limits on bets and games. Other cities will not receive any of the tax revenue to help offset the burden created by additional traffic, intoxicated driving, or any problem gambling issues. All Colorado voters deserve to have a say in activities that impact the entire state.
Next up is Proposition EE. This proposal was placed on the ballot by the Colorado Legislature. If approved, it would increase taxes on cigarettes and tobacco products, create a new tax on nicotine products, including vaping products, and distribute the new revenue to expanded preschool programs, as well as K-12 education, rural schools, affordable housing, eviction assistance, tobacco education, and health care. The tax would be phased in and by 2027 would add a $1.80 tax to a pack of cigarettes.
Those in favor of Proposition EE say the proposed cigarette, tobacco, and nicotine vaping taxes should reduce consumption of highly addictive and harmful products that cause cancer, heart, and lung disease. Colorado has one of the lowest taxes on tobacco and no tax on vaping products, while also having one of the nation's highest rates of nicotine vaping among youth. Proponents also say this measure would fund an innovative, first-in-the-nation approach to preschool. Providing access for up to 10 hours a week of preschool at no cost during the last year before kindergarten would help working families, and high-quality preschool improves educational, health, and economic outcomes later in life.
Opponents say many smokers use vaping products as a way to quit using traditional cigarettes. Taxes on vaping products discourage smokers from quitting. Youth vaping should be addressed through enforcement of existing age restrictions and additional education and prevention. Opponents also say these are regressive taxes that disproportionately harm low-income users of cigarette, tobacco, and nicotine products. Because these products are addictive, users may continue to purchase them even after a tax increase. The state should not depend on tax revenue from addictive products to fund state programs, especially when the tax is intended to decrease consumption of those products.
Next up is Proposition 113, which enters Colorado into an agreement among states to elect the President of the United States by a national popular vote. The agreement only goes into effect for member states once enough states join the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact. The Colorado General Assembly passed legislation to join the compact in the 2019 session. Voters in Colorado have the ability to petition to review legislative actions. A petition effort gathered sufficient signatures to place this question on the 2020 ballot.
Those in favor of Proposition 113 say a national popular vote for president advances the democratic principle of one person, one vote, and ensures that votes in every community count equally. It could encourage candidates to campaign in a way that addresses the concerns of voters in all 50 states. The current system places too much importance on just a few competitive states where candidates focus almost all of their attention and campaign efforts. The national popular vote gives all voters an equal impact on the outcome of the election, regardless of where they live or whether their state's final vote count might be close. Proponents also say the President of the United States should be the person who gets the most popular votes nationwide. 5 times in our country's history, including twice in the last 20 years, a candidate has won the presidential election despite losing the popular vote. A yes vote on Proposition 113 is an important step toward making sure this cannot happen in the future. Recent history demonstrates that when the results are close in even a few states, it is easy for the Electoral College vote to not reflect the national popular vote.
Those opposed to Proposition 113 say Colorado should cast its electoral votes for the candidate who obtains the most votes in Colorado. If the agreement goes into effect, Colorado's presidential electors would be obligated to vote for whomever wins the national popular vote, even if that candidate did not win the majority of votes in the state. Further, a national popular vote may encourage candidates to focus their campaigns in large population centers where they can efficiently reach more voters. In this process, all Coloradoans risk having the unique regional issues they care about lose out to the interest of a few large cities in a few large states. Opponents also say this agreement attempts to sidestep the U.S. Constitution and could lead to disruptions in our electoral system. Rather than amend the U.S. Constitution to implement a true national popular vote, the compact relies on legal agreements between member states to ensure that their electors will vote the way the compact demands. However, states have different election requirements and policies. In addition, a close election run by 50 separate states trying to determine who won the national popular vote could lead to recounts and litigation in every state, delaying results, causing confusion, and eroding confidence in our electoral system.
Proposition 114 is up next. It's a citizen initiative which proposes amending the Colorado statutes to require the state to develop a plan to reintroduce and manage gray wolves in Colorado. Take necessary steps to begin reintroduction by December 31st, 2023, and pay fair compensation for livestock losses caused by gray wolves.
Those in favor of Proposition 114 say reintroducing wolves would go far to restore the natural balance to Colorado Rocky Mountain wildlife for generations to come. Without them, the deer and elk population can overgraze sensitive habitats. This would ensure a permanent gray wolf population to the state and would benefit the fish, wildlife, and plant communities of the region, including growth of streamside vegetation that has benefited fish, amphibians, beaver, and songbirds. Proponents also say this has been done in other states with successful recovery efforts.
Opponents say the presence of wolves can cause conflict with humans and animals that live in Colorado. Gray wolves are known to prey on livestock, particularly when the deer populations are low in certain areas of the state. Opponents also say since gray wolves from neighboring states have already been seen, it seems that wolves may be establishing their own presence, making a program unnecessary. Allowing wolves to come back on their own would give Coloradans more time to adapt to their presence.
Next up is Proposition 115, a citizen initiative which proposes to prohibit abortion after 22 weeks gestational age of the fetus, except when an abortion is immediately required to save the life of a pregnant woman, create a criminal penalty for any person who performs a prohibited abortion, and require that the state suspend the medical license for at least 3 years of any physician who violates this measure.
Those in favor of Proposition 115 say the measure places a reasonable restriction on abortion after viability while still allowing a pregnant woman several months to make a choice about her pregnancy. Proponents also say the measure provides an exception that allows an abortion after 22 weeks when necessary to save the life of the mother. And in no case can a woman be criminalized or penalized for seeking an abortion if this measure passes. This is a balanced approach with reasonable exceptions to a very personal issue.
Those opposed to Proposition 115 say that this one-size-fits-all measure would hurt real people going through unimaginably complicated personal situations. Opponents also say choices around pregnancy are best made by a woman and her family, in consultation with her doctors and in accordance with her faith, not by politicians. And this proposal is an intentionally confusing initiative being pushed by many of the same politicians and groups who have repeatedly tried to ban abortion outright in Colorado.
The citizen-initiated Proposition 116 proposes amending the Colorado statutes to reduce the state income tax rate from 4.63% to 4.55% for tax year 2020 and future years. The measure is expected to reduce state income tax revenue by $154 million in state budget year 2021 to 2022. This is equal to 1.2% of expected state general fund revenue for that year.
Those in favor say at a time when households and businesses are struggling to make ends meet, Proposition 116 leaves more money in the pocket of every taxpayer. Allowing taxpayers to keep more of their earnings will promote spending, business investment, and employment. Proponents also say after years of growth in the state's budget, the state government can handle a small tax decrease to provide relief to families and businesses. Even with the tax reduction under Proposition 116, state revenue is expected to increase in the next budget year. The measure only modestly slows the rate by which it will grow. Households that are struggling and foregoing basic purchases need their earnings more than the state government does.
Opponents say reducing state revenue will compound the impact of significant budget cuts already being made to education, transportation, healthcare programs, and other state services as a result of the current economic crisis. Additional loss of state revenue will cause layoffs and reduce critical state services, further hurting Colorado's economy and quality of life. Now is not the time to reduce state revenue further. Most of the measure's benefits will go to only a very small population of very wealthy taxpayers, including corporations. About 75% of taxpayers will receive a tax cut of less than $50 per year. Comparatively, those with incomes over $500,000, representing less than 2% of taxpayers, will receive over half the total tax savings.
Next up is Proposition 117, citizen-initiated, and it proposes amending the Colorado statutes to require a voter approval for new state government-owned businesses, called enterprises, if the enterprise's revenue from fees over its first 5 years exceeds $100 million, and requires that specific language be included on the ballot when voters are asked to approve enterprises. An enterprise is a largely self-funded government-owned business that charges user fees in exchange for services provided. Money collected by an enterprise is not subject to the state's constitutional revenue limit, also called the Taxpayer's Bill of Rights, or TABOR. Examples of existing enterprises include state colleges and universities, Colorado Parks and Wildlife, and Colorado Lottery.
Those in favor of Proposition 117 say it strengthens the role of citizens in determining the proper size and scope of government. The state government uses enterprises to grow its budget without voter approval. Proponents also say Coloradans approved TABOR to require voter consent for tax increases. This measure extends this principle to fees collected by large new enterprises. Fees, like taxes, are paid by everyday Coloradans and businesses, so voters should have a say in their creation.
Those opposed to Proposition 117 say enterprises were specifically exempted from the spending restrictions of TABOR and work as intended. They shift the responsibility for paying for a government-provided service from all taxpayers to the people who use and benefit from the service. Opponents also say if fewer enterprises are created as a result of Proposition 117, the state may be forced to choose between using tax revenue to pay for critical services that otherwise would be funded through user fees or not providing those services.
Another citizen initiative, Proposition 118, proposes amending the Colorado statutes to create a paid family and medical leave insurance program for Colorado employees administered by the Colorado Department of Labor and Employment. It will require employers and employees in Colorado to pay a payroll premium to finance paid family and medical leave insurance benefits beginning January 1, 2023. Allow eligible employees up to 12 weeks of paid family and medical leave insurance benefits annually beginning January 1, 2024, and create job protections for employees who take paid family and medical leave.
Those in favor of Proposition 118 say nearly everyone will need to take time to care for themselves, a newborn baby, or a seriously ill family member at some point. But today, only 1 in 5 Colorado workers has access to paid family and medical leave, and those that need it the most are the least likely to have it. A lack of paid family and medical leave coverage has become glaringly obvious during the coronavirus pandemic. Proponents also say this proposal would make sure 2.6 million hardworking Coloradoans can put their families first without having to risk losing their job. It also protects small businesses by allowing them to offer paid leave to their employees without having to pay for it, helping them compete with large corporations who can afford to offer this type of benefit.
Opponents say this measure is a $1.3 billion tax increase that requires employees to pay into a program that they may never benefit from using. Employees are already faced with job uncertainty in the current economy and cannot afford to lose part of their salary or other benefits. If the demand for the benefit is higher than expected, employees will be expected to contribute an even larger percentage of wages in the future or sacrifice other workplace gains. Opponents also say this measure creates a new and expensive bureaucracy with almost 200 employees and a director that is a political appointee who has little accountability. With so many unmet needs in Colorado, like teacher pay and transportation, this is a program we cannot afford.
Those are the statewide issues you'll be voting on this fall. Again, you can get more information about these ballot measures. All Denver households with registered voters should have received a Colorado Blue Book mailed by the Secretary of State's office. In addition, you can get information on these issues from the League of Women Voters of Colorado. Go to lwvcolorado.org. And you can watch ballot issue forums be debated at denverdecides.org. We'll get to the local issues when we return. Now on to the city issues. For these issues, you can get more information about them from your local ballot issue notice. All Denver households with registered voters will get a copy. You can go to denvervotes.org to download a copy if you haven't received it. You can also get information on these issues from the League of Women Voters of Denver at lwvdenver.org. The first of the city issues is ballot measure 2A. 2A asks if the City and County of Denver's sales and use taxes should be increased to fund programs to eliminate greenhouse gas emissions and air pollution and adapt to climate change. The tax would be 25/100%. This equals 2.5 cents on a $10 purchase. The tax would not apply to food, water, and other necessities. It is expected to raise $40 million annually and would begin January 1, 2021. The tax would be used for job creation through local workforce training and new careers for under-resourced individuals in renewable and clean energy technology, increased investments in solar power and other renewable energy technology, neighborhood-based environmental and climate justice programs, clean transportation programs, and upgrading the energy efficiency of homes, offices, and industry. This dedicated funding should maximize investments in communities of color, under-resourced communities, and communities most vulnerable to climate change. Here are the pros and cons for 2A.
Those in favor of referred question 2A say, climate change is a serious problem that must be addressed. Addressing climate change now is costly, but costs will increase if we delay. The federal government is the best place to address climate change, but they have abdicated their role. This measure will make Denver a leader in climate change efforts.
Those opposed to referred question 2A say, a sales tax is the wrong way to fund this effort. The sales tax does not change behavior, as would be the case with a tax on energy consumption. Sales taxes are regressive by their nature. This is a national or global problem. These efforts will be costly in Denver while having a minimal effect on climate.
Next up is ballot measure 2B. It asks if the city should increase sales and use tax to fund housing, shelter, or services for people experiencing homelessness. The tax would be 25/100%, which equals 2.5 cents on a $10 purchase. The tax would not apply to food, water, and other necessities. It is expected to raise $40 million annually and would begin January 1, 2021. Here are the pros and cons for 2B.
Proponents say, ballot measure 2B will make critical investments to help individuals experiencing homelessness get back on their feet, find housing and employment, and access critical treatment programs. It would build supportive housing and expand rental assistance in Denver, including 1,800 homes over the next 10 years, increase the number of available shelter beds in Denver, and provide funding for innovative programs, including expanding the use of tiny homes, hiring street outreach workers, and providing medical, mental health, and substance abuse treatment programs. These funds would help to sustain Denver's COVID-19 emergency response.
Opponents say while homelessness can be devastating to all who experience it, it makes little sense to increase Denver's sales tax rate, a regressive tax seriously impacting those who can least afford it. If both sales tax increase measures on Denver's ballot pass, our sales tax rate, including state and regional taxes, will be in the upper tier of taxes in the region, a total of 8.81%. An increase in Denver's sales tax makes our businesses less competitive and requires our residents to pay more. This reduces employment opportunities and pushes more people into homelessness. All government and nonprofit providers should be scrutinized before taxpayers are asked to pay more. And increasing taxes for new programs while cutting critical city services such as police and fire, recreation centers, and libraries makes no sense.
Next up, ballot measure 2C, which amends the charter to give city council the authority to procure professional services without executive branch approval.
Those in favor of 2C say, to fulfill its charter responsibilities, the council may need to engage experts independent of the mayor. This measure will not interfere with or create confusion about who represents the city in legal matters. Funds for professional services will come from the council's budget.
There were no comments against the measure filed by the deadline.
Ballot Measure 2D is next. It asks if the city charter should be amended to create the Board of Transportation and Infrastructure to advise the manager with respect to the policy and operation of the department. The board would also review and comment on the proposed annual budget for the department.
Those in favor of 2D say this proposal adds an official avenue for citizen input on issues relating to transportation in particular. Citizens do not currently have this avenue for comment on services that are vitally important to many.
No opposing comments were filed by the deadline.
Next, question 2E asks if the Charter of the City and County of Denver be amended to give City Council authority to consent to certain mayoral appointments.
Those in favor of 2E say it brings transparency and accountability back to our local government. In addition to the Chiefs of Police and Fire and the Denver Sheriff, a majority of City Council members would have to approve the City Attorney, Executive Directors of Aviation, Community Planning and Development, and many other agencies. City Council members in the majority of Denver's strong mayor sister cities have some form of approval power over the mayor's appointees. Denver is the only strong mayor system in the state of Colorado that does not follow this practice. This proposal is respectful of Denver's strong mayor system. The mayor is free to choose his or her appointee, but by establishing this additional layer of oversight, Denver residents have a more powerful voice in their local government through their independently elected City Council representatives. This proposal builds consensus among the community by including all of the heads of Denver's safety departments. It offers a middle ground for those who would like to see an elected sheriff or police chief, and those who have concerns about the unintended consequences of electing Denver's public safety heads, and the measure safeguards against nepotism and unqualified appointees.
Those opposed to 2E say the current City Council that is asking for the power of confirmation has yet to establish its own credibility. It has acted without thought of consequences, such as unexpectedly rejecting contracts for halfway houses with no subsequent plans in place for hundreds of people counting on a phased re-entry to society. This type of impulsive approach to governing undermines council's credibility. Finding the right person to apply for a cabinet position can be difficult under normal circumstances. Members of this council have launched public personal attacks on applicants for volunteer boards. Does this behavior lend itself to attracting highly professional applicants for jobs within the city? Adopting this amendment could create unique timing problems. This amendment would require confirmation of all existing department heads, should the current mayor leave office for any reason, and a new mayor who wishes to retain the current lineup be sworn in, such as when Mayor John Hickenlooper left office to become governor. This charter amendment calls for the confirmation of each individual safety department head, fire, police, and sheriff, as well as the cabinet-level director of public safety. It will be hard to hold the mayor accountable if the nominee has to please council members who advocate defunding and encourage protest and lawsuits. While the concept of council confirmation has pros and cons, it would be wise to reject the charter amendment at this time and refile it for a public vote when City Council has established its own stability and credibility.
Next up is 2F, which asks if the city charter be updated to remove outdated language and allow for modernization of the conduct of city business.
Those in favor of 2F say during the COVID-19 emergency, it became clear that some of the language in the Denver Charter could potentially restrict council's ability to do business during times of emergency. In-person meetings, open to public attendance, are not currently desirable. This charter change would keep the requirements of openness and transparency, but would allow for remote or online meetings. Meetings would still be required to be fully recorded, and all records would still be available. Moving prescriptive language from the charter to ordinance will allow council to make changes to rules if they become necessary.
No opposing comments were filed by the deadline.
Now on to 2G, which asks if the city charter be amended to give the city council authority to initiate a supplemental appropriation or transfer following consultation with the manager of finance.
Those in favor of 2G say council should have more than one chance a year to propose uses for the city's funds. Council is perceived by the public to have a responsibility for how the city's money is appropriated, while the mayor and the cabinet must propose any mid-year changes to respond to issues. This amendment would bring council abilities in line with the community's expectations. A number of cities comparable to Denver specifically allow their council to initiate this type of transfer, including Philadelphia, Detroit, and San Francisco.
Opponents of 2G say having council members introduce supplemental appropriations or transfers at any time for their pet projects could be highly disruptive to funding of basic services. The administration needs time to research and negotiate proposed changes. It is this type of legitimate pushback from the administration that council members are trying to quickly circumvent. The mayor's office needs to retain flexibility in uses of funds, especially during times of reduced revenue or unanticipated emergency needs for funds. Council can respond to any mid-year changes proposed by the mayor or the cabinet.
2H is up next. This measure would, without increasing taxes, reestablish the city's right to provide high-speed internet, telecommunication services, and cable television services to residents, businesses, schools, and other users, either directly or indirectly with public or private sector partners. The measure reestablishes this right, which was restricted since 2005 by the Colorado General Assembly with their passage of Senate Bill 152. It establishes the authority, but not obligation, to provide these services.
Those in favor of referred question 2H say those who are not sufficiently connected to the internet are at a competitive disadvantage in their education and work lives. Thousands of Denver homes are still without broadband connectivity, mostly affecting traditionally underserved communities. While much of Denver is well served by a roster of commercial broadband providers, the remaining gaps must be filled. If the commercial providers cannot find a way to provide internet access to all, then we must be free as a city, as a last resort, to step into the gap ourselves if that is what is required. Most of the 100-plus Colorado cities that have passed Senate Bill 152 questions have not sought to provide services, but sought more flexibility in negotiating with existing commercial relationships. This proposal does not obligate any public dollars and does not infer city construction of broadband infrastructure. It merely enables a more complete discussion of options to solving the critical problems that lack of connectivity may cause.
No opposing comments were filed by the deadline.
Ballot Measure 2I would clarify that the clerk and recorder may appoint 4 at-will employees in addition to the deputy. All of these will be exempt from the career service personnel system.
Those in favor of 2I say the amendment clarifies the number of employees that the clerk and recorder may appoint in his or her office. This amendment will make the legislative intent explicitly clear. This amendment will ensure that the office and its employees are accountable to the clerk and recorder. Some high-level positions are appointed by the clerk, some are career service employees. Because the clerk is ultimately responsible to the voters for how the office runs, he wants high-level employees to be responsible to him. And this will be a budget-neutral charter amendment because the clerk will use these appointments on positions that already exist in the city's budget.
Those opposed to 2I say it is a deceitfully omissive ballot question that disguises the hidden consequence. Though it is not clearly stated, a vote for the ballot question will strike from Denver City Charter the duty of the clerk and recorder to employ a director of elections. This is a position that voters have already twice affirmed is an essential role. The critical position of director of elections has been our safeguard that the voting chaos of 2006 would never happen again. Opponents question why voters are being asked during an economic and unemployment crisis to approve that the city fund even more unspecified appointee positions. And they question why the existing career service personnel system is not sufficient for any additional positions that are truly needed.
Next up is question 2J. This measure would allow pit bulls in Denver, provided the owner microchips and spays or neuters the animal, and complies with additional requirements set by Denver Animal Protection.
Those in favor of 2J say breed-specific bans do not work, they don't make Denver safer, and they don't encourage responsible dog ownership. A dog's breed is not an indicator of whether or not a dog will bite. Responsible ownership is. There are no controlled studies that show pit bulls are any more dangerous than any other breed. Pit bull bans and any laws specific to breed are opposed by groups including the Humane Society, the American Veterinary Medicine Association, the ASPCA, and the American Bar Association. Owners will be required to notify animal control if their dog escapes or bites anyone, and only two permitted dogs will be allowed in a home. These measures will encourage responsible dog ownership and allow Denverites to stay safe.
Opponents say Denver's pit bull ban was enacted in 1989 after 20 people had been attacked by pit bulls in the previous 5 years. One was a 3-year-old who was fatally attacked in 1986. The ban, considered a safety issue, was upheld by the Colorado Supreme Court in 1991. The Denver City Council narrowly voted to repeal the ban earlier this year. Mayor Hancock successfully vetoed the attempt. Previous city councils considered and rejected a repeal. The pit bull ban has worked in Denver. No pit bull fatalities have been reported since the ban's enactment. The ordinance that banned pit bulls continues to meet its safety goal. We do not want to end a 30-year success story.
Ballot Measure 4A asks if Denver Public Schools taxes be increased up to $32 million in tax collection year 2021 to fund purposes such as adding and maintaining mental health professionals and school counselors to support students, adding and maintaining school nurses to support COVID-19 monitoring and prevention, as well as other health education, increasing minimum wages for school support staff, and adding cost of living funds to pay educators a living wage. Additional revenues from this tax increase would be used for ongoing cash funding for capital construction, new instructional technology, existing technology upgrades, and maintenance needs of the district. This is a mill levy increase, which affects property taxes.
Those in favor say by approving 4A, Denver voters will make public education a priority this year, ensure every student receives a high-quality education, increase graduation rates, reduce class sizes, and help Denver's kids get the education they deserve in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Every child in our city deserves an equal chance to succeed academically, and each teacher deserves the tools to make that happen. Denver schools have made a lot of progress, but we have seen that some of our students are being left behind, especially our most vulnerable during COVID-19.
No arguments were filed by the deadline.
Finally on the ballot is Measure 4B, which asks if Denver Public Schools' debt be increased $795 million. This measure does not impose any new tax. The funds would be used for maintaining and renovating existing school buildings, provide cooling systems for classrooms that lack air conditioning, adding new schools to address overcrowding, purchasing additional computers so that students have access to technology they need during the COVID-19 pandemic and beyond, improving learning environments in older school buildings by upgrading science and computer labs, improving student safety and security, improving early childhood learning environments, and other capital improvements. The Denver Public Schools is proposing this bond issue to raise money for these capital building projects and upgrades. A bond issue affects the taxes a property owner pays.
Proponents of 4B say over the past decade, Denver's population has grown by more than 20%. Denver Public Schools has seen an increase in over 15,000 students in that time. With this unprecedented growth comes additional needs, and our schools have taken another major hit during the COVID-19 pandemic. Proponents also say the average age of Denver Public School-owned buildings is over 50 years old. This year, Denver's voters have an opportunity to modernize and provide public schools with the resources needed to succeed in the current education environment, all without raising taxes.
No arguments against this question were filed by the deadline.
Those are the issues you'll be voting on this fall. The Denver Decides partners sponsored forums for many of these ballot issues. You can watch the forums on Denver 8 TV or online at denverdecides.org. Again, you can refer to your state and city ballot guides for more information. All Denver households with registered voters will get these guides. And you can get information on these issues from the League of Women Voters of Denver and of Colorado. go to lwvdenver.org and lwvcolorado.org. Before we get to the candidates, we'll take a break. Now, here are the candidates running. You can also watch forums for the local candidate races from our Denver Decides partnership. In ballot order, here they are and where you can get more information about them.
For President of the United States, there are many pairs of candidates on the Denver ballot. First, from the Democratic ticket, is Joseph R. Biden, Democrat, with his running mate Kamala D. Harris, joebiden.com. Next up is incumbent Republican Donald J. Trump, with running mate Michael R. Pence, donaldjtrump.com. There are also several other presidential and vice presidential pairs of candidates seeking the country's top job. They represent numerous party-affiliated and unaffiliated office seekers. Here is a list of presidential candidates on the Denver ballot.
Voters across the state will decide on the next United States Senator. The candidates are Democrat John W. Hickenlooper, hickenlooper.com, Republican incumbent Cory Gardner, corygardner.com, from the Approval Voting Party, Daniel Doyle, Stephen Sekou Evans, Unity Party of Colorado, electsekou.com, Libertarian Raymond Anthony Doan.
And for the races for Denver voters, for United States House of Representatives District 1, the choices are Republican Shane Bowling, shaneforco.com, Democrat incumbent Diana DeGette, DeGette.com, Paul Noel Fiorino, Unity Party, fiorinoforcolorado.com, Jan Koch, Approval Voting Party, and Libertarian Kyle Furey.
For State Board of Education, District 1, the candidates are Republican Sydnia Wolf, Democrat Lisa Iskarsika, lisaiskarsika.com, Zachary Lattison, Approval Voting Party, and Libertarian Alan Heyman, lpcolorado.org.
For State Senator, District 31, in the central, east, and southeast part of town, voters will choose between Democrat Chris Hansen, hansenforcolorado.com, and Republican Doug Townsend, dougtownsendforyou.com.
Voters in the north and northeast part of town will make the choice for State Senator, District 33, between James Rashad Coleman, Democrat, colemanforcolorado.com, and Jerry Burton, Unity Party.
Voters will also pick their state representative in the fall election. In District 1, in the southwest part of town, the choices are Democrat Susan Lontine, susanlontinehd1.com, and Republican Samantha Cook, samanthaforcoloradovalues.com.
In District 2, in west and south central Denver, the candidates are Alec Garnett, Democrat, garnettforcolorado.com, and Victoria Partridge, Republican.
Voters in District 4 in far northwest Denver will pick between Republican Grant Price and Democrat Serena Gonzalez Gutierrez, serenaforcolorado.com.
Voters in District 5 in west and north Denver will have three choices. From the Republican Party, Jonathan Woodley, jpwoodley.com. From the Democratic Party, Alex Valdez, valdezforcolorado.com. And from the Unity Party of Colorado, Joe Richardson.
The candidates in District 6 in Central and East Denver are Republican Bill McCaleb, billbringsit.com, Democrat Stephen Woodrow, woodrowforco.com, and Libertarian Jeffrey Kennedy Crow.
Voters in District 7 in far Northeast Denver will have one choice. Democrat Jennifer Bacon, elect JenniferBacon.com. She is running unopposed.
The candidate in Northeast Denver for District 8 is Democrat Leslie Herod, LeslieHerodForColorado.com. There is no Republican candidate for this office.
Finally, in District 9 in Southeast Denver, the candidates are Larry L. Bragg for the Republicans, BraggForSafety.com, Emily Sirota for the Democrats, EmilyForColorado.com, and Wes Pinchot for Libertarians.
Running for District Attorney, District 2, is Beth McCann, Democrat, McCannForDenverDA.org, and William F. Robinson III, Libertarian.
For the Regional Transportation Director, District A, voters will choose between Tim Nelson, NelsonForRTD.com, Kate Williams, and Kyle Bradell.
For the Regional Transportation Director, District D, Bobby Deschel is running unopposed. DeschelForRTD.com.
In RTD's District E, Paul Rosenthal is running unopposed. PaulForRTD.com.
Finally, voters will also be asked whether or not to retain judges from several districts and jurisdictions, which will return them to the bench. The following is a list of the judges on the ballot. You can get a full review of all commission recommendations and each individual's complete judicial review at the website cojudicialperformance.com. All these judges have been rated and meet performance standards. As we mentioned, the Denver Decides Partners sponsored forums for many of these seats. All candidates were invited to participate. Some chose not to. You can see all the forums online at denverdecides.org or watch on Denver 8 TV. You can get the schedule for the televised forums at denver8.tv. Denver has been a pioneer in conducting safe, secure mail-in elections and has successfully conducted mail-in elections for years. Your Denver Local Ballot Issue Notice and inserts sent along with your ballot have all the information you need to make sure your vote counts. You can also visit denvervotes.org. If you haven't registered or if you need to verify or change your information, go to govotecolorado.com. You can return your ballot one of three ways: by mail, drop it off at one of the drop boxes, or bring it to a voter service and polling center. You can text VSPC to 56003 for the nearest ballot drop-off location. You can also track your ballot through the entire process with Ballot Trace. Sign up at ballottrace.org or text TRACE to 56003. If you need a new ballot or didn't get a ballot, visit denvervotes.org/voterinfo to request a ballot for curbside pickup or call 311. Remember, in order for your vote to count, be sure your ballot arrives by 7 p.m. on Election Day, Tuesday, November 3rd. Thanks for watching, and be sure to exercise your right as an American and vote.